The psalmist writes, "Ascribe to the Lord the glory of his name. Worship the Lord in holy splendor." We're glad you have joined us to worship with the people of First Presbyterian Church of Ponca City, Oklahoma. We worship virtually to protect the health of those who regularly worship with us and to help protect our community as well. We're glad you're here. We also gather virtually for a Bring Your Own Cookie Fellowship at 11 o'clock on Sunday. You'll find the link to that Zoom meeting in your weekly email. It's Sunday, February 21st, the first Sunday of Lent. Please join me in our opening sentences. We have entered the season of Lent, a time to examine our hearts and our lives and journey with Christ through the sufferings of the world. Let us lift up our souls to our merciful God and humble ourselves in God's service. God has marked us as beloved dust and called us together in worship. The writer of 1 John reminds us, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Will you join me in the prayer of confession? In the season of Lent, O God, we say lofty words about renewing our spiritual disciplines, journeying with you to the cross, or denying ourselves material wants for the good of the soul. Forgive us, O God, if our actions are in vain, if we're concerned with the good of our soul rather than the good of your people, if we have twisted this season of penitence into a reason for praise or judgment, if we are so preoccupied with the sins of the world that we cannot recognize and confess the sins of our own lives, forgive us, O God, and wash us in your mercy. Forgive us, O God, and free us to try again. Friends, if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
As we approach God's word written, let us approach that word in prayer. Dear God, on this very cold and frosty February day, we thank you for your gift of love, for your gift of forgiveness, for your gift of the rainbow that reminds us of how much you love us. Help us to hear this word from Genesis, that we might be touched by the power of your word written and led forth to follow your word made flesh in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear God's word from the book of Genesis, the 9th chapter, beginning with verse 8. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "As for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and with your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as come out of the ark. I establish my covenant with you, that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth. God said, this is the sign of the covenant that I will make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign for the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the water shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all the flesh that lives on the earth. God said to Noah, this is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This morning, our gospel reading is from Mark, chapter 1, beginning with verse 9. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." The Gospel of our Lord. Let's pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. On the first Sunday of Lent, We read two stories that seem very different. They are, however, both stories about people struggling with overwhelming situations. That seems like an appropriate place for us to begin Lent this year, doesn't it? Sometimes, apparently unrelated things turn out to have deep connections. My Old Testament professor used to love to tell a story from his days at Yale. Yale has an archaeology lab. From time to time, Yale would receive rather exciting artifacts from archaeological digs in the Middle East. They were things you would expect: shards of pottery, stone, clay tablets, a scrap of fabric, a piece of a basket. For years, two esteemed professors had argued over a small clay tablet with a bit of cuneiform writing on it. They disagreed sharply on the translation of the tablet and could never really reconcile their readings. Of course, they both knew that part of the inscription was missing. One semester, they introduced master's level students to the lab. What a pair of fresh eyes can do. After a few days observing artifacts, one of the students quietly took one of the professors aside and said, "Maybe you should see this." He picked up a basket found in the same excavation as the clay tablet and gently sat it on the tablet. The bottom of the basket fit into the markings on the tablet precisely. For years, the professors had attempted to translate markings left by a basket. Sometimes seemingly unrelated things are significantly related, like a broken basket and a fragment of clay tablet. So it is with biblical stories. What do these scriptures about an arid, rocky wilderness and an extended, devastating flood have in common? On the surface, not much, right? They almost seem like opposites. The underlying theology of Genesis has left an impression on the writer of our gospel, just as the basket left a mark on the clay. The writers of our Old Testament broke away from every other understanding of God in the ancient world and gave us a picture of a God that cares about humanity, loves humanity, and all of creation. That leaves an impression on our gospel reading. In a sense, we're really talking about two biblical writers, one writing about 600 years or so before Jesus was born, and the other writing 70 years after Jesus was born, who had a great deal of life experience in common. They both have been through great catastrophes that devastated their beloved homeland. The Old Testament writer was telling a story of a great flood, a story that had been handed down from generation to generation for centuries. When his beloved Jerusalem was destroyed by the Babylonians and his people were scattered as exiles across the ancient Near East, he found it urgently necessary to write down the story and make certain the story, an important part of his faith heritage, was never lost. The New Testament writer, who gives us the Gospel of Mark, was facing a crisis also. His homeland had been devastated by Rome, and it was urgently necessary that as Christians fled Jerusalem to Asia, Europe, and Africa, that the story of Jesus' life be preserved in writing. The writers were sharing their faith story from very different points in history, yet the writers were sharing the same huge truth. The stories they told were not really about rising waters, floating zoos, arid sands, or wild beasts. The stories they told were meant to share how the writers understood the nature of God. They were about the way humans experience God. Let's look together for a few moments at the flood story. It follows shortly after the creation story, and frankly, it's a do-over. God had spoken an amazing world into existence by taming the chaotic waters, separating the waters into the heavens and the seas. When human existence became too violent and obnoxious, according to the ancients, God opted to let the chaotic waters come back together in a great flood. Yet God would not, could not, completely give up on humanity or creation. So he called out to a righteous man named Noah to build an ark and gather up a remnant of humanity and animals and lead them into that ark. God protected them from the impending flood. The waters came for days. When the devastation was over, the Bible tells us God was a little sorry. God made a promise that there would never be such a devastating flood again. God set his bow in the sky to be a reminder to humanity and to himself that there is a covenant between God and humans. God sets the rainbow, the bow, in the heavens. In the ancient text, the word bow is just that, the weapon used to shoot arrows. Across most of the ancient world, gods were thought of as warriors. They rode the storm clouds like chariots. They shot down arrows and spears of lightning at the earth and at humans. They were troublemakers that needed to be appeased at every turn, or crops didn't grow, rains didn't come, and children weren't born. They waged war on humanity for the sport of it, but not this God, not the God of Israel. The God of Israel would be different. God hung up his bow, and as a promise of his presence and protection, God hung it in the sky just a certain way, with the arch of the bow facing so that it could only shoot arrows away from the earth, not toward the earth. An ancient story, so, so distant, such a different view of the world, and yet even then, a writer, an early theologian, was beginning to understand that his God was not the enemy. God desires a relationship with us, and so would never shoot his arrows toward humanity again. So fast forward through the centuries to the writing of the Gospel of Mark. Another theologian struggles with the events all around him. His beloved Jerusalem had fallen. Jesus had been crucified 40 years earlier, yet his followers were still having powerful experiences of Jesus alive and present among them, especially when they gathered at his table. Now Rome had destroyed Jerusalem and most Christians had fled for their lives. Perhaps somewhere in what was war-torn Syria, a person began writing down the stories of Jesus he had heard over the decades. It was a brief writing, intentionally brief enough that it could be read in its entirety during one worship service. In that story of Jesus, he writes of Jesus' baptism and immediately follows the account of the baptism with a story of the temptation. Jesus was thrown, yes, thrown is the word he used in the Greek, into the desert for days and days. Jesus was flung into a place where wild beasts roamed and food and water were scarce, thrown into the place where lepers and outcasts and bandits lived. There, the writer tells us, Jesus was tempted by Satan. But this is not the devil of Greek mythology with his red face, with horns and a pitchfork. This is the Satan of the Old Testament, part of God's heavenly entourage. This is the Satan we find in the book of Job. This is the Satan that God has chosen to be his chief policy analyst. His responsibility is to test God's ideas. This is the Satan that says to God, if you took away all your blessing and protection from this guy Job, he would curse you instantly. This is the Satan that knows God well, talks to him, and his responsibility is to be sure there are no loopholes in God's plans. In the desert, he turns his attention to Jesus. If Jesus were not part of God's plan, Satan would have nothing to do with him, would not have wasted his time on him. Mark says Satan tempted Jesus for 40 days. That's a lot of strategy analysis. Mark also says angels attended Jesus. In Greek, the word angels simply means messenger. God was sending messages to Jesus in this difficult time. God stayed in touch with Jesus in the wilderness during trying times. There may have been powerful forces, there may have been beasts with fangs and claws, but in his own way, Mark tells us God was present to Jesus the whole time he was in the wilderness. Two ancient stories, frightening stories written centuries apart about the same God that contain one truth. God has promised to be present to us. Here we are in the beginning of the season of Lent. Lent is really a good time to begin to deal with our own frightening stories. Which one are you living in? Are you dealing with a flood? Are you overwhelmed by your current situation? Did you feel as though you're going under for the third time? In the future, we'll be telling our descendants the story of the great pandemic. We'll tell them of the unemployment, of the political upheaval. We'll tell them how the pandemic stripped bare the ugliest parts of our culture to reveal racism and the divide between the rich and the poor. We find ourselves mourning, mourning for the dead, for the nation, for the way things used to be. Are you drowning in grief or depression or multiple burdens that you find hard to share? The good news is the bow is pointed away from you. God's not out to get you. God is with us. God wants a relationship with you. And Lent is a good time to spend a little more time absorbing that relationship. Maybe you're in the desert today. Maybe you feel parched and dry, a little bored and lonely in the isolation. Maybe you're hungry and you don't even really know what you want. Maybe you feel that you're in danger. Maybe health issues stalk you like a wild beast in the desert. God is there with you. Listen for God, especially during this season of Lent. What we've read together this morning is our common human experience. We've read sophisticated metaphors written by insightful authors, stories with layer after layer of meaning. We have the story of a devastating flood that's also the story of a writer suffering under Babylonian exile who not only preserved the story of the flood but identified with the story of the flood and felt he had been washed away himself. It became his story. He reappropriated the story for his own time. We have the story of Jesus in the wilderness and the writer 40 years later who preserved the story because he was in the wilderness as well. He was living in a foreign place and felt as if the wild beast had devoured his homeland and his temple, and he was tempted to constant fear and doubt. The story had become his story, and it's our story as well. These stories preserved the very same thought. Whatever wilderness you find yourself in, whatever dire straits you encounter, when floodwaters rise around you, when hot winds parch you and leave you thirsting, when wild beasts threaten, God is there. These are our stories because we find ourselves in floods and deserts far too often. The good news is through Jesus Christ, we're never there alone. When floods come, we still see the bow turned away from us. And when we find ourselves facing beasts and hunger in the desert, we still hear the whispered messages of hope from God. Even in the desert, even in the flood, there are times when the presence of God is unmistakable. We are not on this journey alone. Thanks be to God. Amen. Pray together. God of loving kindness, we give you thanks for moments of joy and celebration in our lives, for times of excitement and expectation, for love given and received, for friendships which furnish our life with meaning and happiness, and for family members who show us glimpses of unconditional love. Let us once again renew our commitment to serve one another, commit ourselves to the common good, and work for peace in all relationships and interactions. Keep us mindful of your call to see you in one another. God of the nations, we pray for our country and for the countries of this world, for all those who frame laws and shape society, for those who keep the peace and administer justice. in governments and countries where the innocent are punished and the weak serve the wealthy, move in the hearts and minds of those with power so that all will know justice and freedom. God of healing, we pray for those who suffer and are ill, and for those who mourn and fear for the future. Surround them with your love, support them with strength, and open our hearts and our eyes to see how we might bring comfort in situations of hurt and pain. Be with all those who give of themselves to care for the ill. We ask in love and in trust in the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now may the grace of Jesus, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit go with you and all those you love, now and forever. Amen.